What do you think, Iz? It's called disco skating.
Oh, disco skating.
Don't worry, I have a secret weapon. I figured out a lighting plan to make me a star. Ta-da! What do you think?
We went stargazing, and we couldn't see many stars outside.
Light pollution is actually a really big environmental problem.
Jupiter.
I'm looking up. Whoa, whoa!
Star party!
Next on SciGirls. Major funding for SciGirls is provided by the National Science Foundation, supporting education and research across all fields of science and engineering. The National Science Foundation, where discoveries begin.
Additional funding is provided by ExxonMobil.
SciGirls! We need you!
SciGirls! Come on!
When I need help and I've got a question, there's a place I go for inspiration. Gotta get to the web, check the girls' investigation. One girl!
What do you think, Iz? It's called disco skating.
Oh, disco skating. Wow, that's your talent for the talent show?
Yep, I can't really skate, can't really dance, but together, it's a golden combination. And don't worry, I have a secret weapon.
Secret weapon?
Meet me at school, and I'll show you.
Wow, that is not gonna be a secret for long.
I don't want it to be. I want everyone's eyes on me. And I figured out a lighting plan to make me a star. Ta-da! What do you think? Can't take your eyes off my board, right?
Actually, I can't really see it. Hang on. Let me take a picture and I'll show you. Here, start skating again. See?
Hey, where do my lights go? I can barely see them.
I know. It's weird.
And devastating to my chances of winning. If the judges just judge me on my dancing, I'm in trouble.
Yeah, I've seen your dancing. I'll tell you what. I'll see if the SciGirls can help. Woohoo! let's see. How do I make Jake shine? Oh. Hey, Jake wants to be a star. Maybe this'll help.
So why don't we decorate the table with these glow-in-the-dark stars? It's fun decorating. It's fun.
My name is Miranda, and I'm 12 years old. And I also have a nickname, which is Miri.
So taking out the constellation chart so that our friends aren't lost trying to look at the sky.
And maybe we can get out the box of stars so they can see what different constellations there are.
My name's Avianna. I'm 12 years old. What I want to be when I grow up is a forensic scientist. The thing that I love most about astronomy is that we get to go outside and locate stars and constellations that you've never seen before.
We're about to prepare ourselves for our star party that we're hosting.
Avi and I are both part of the Science Club for Girls.
Okay, so why don't we check on the telescopes? Need to put on the viewfinder.
I'll put the eyepiece in.
We're very excited to show all our friends what we've been doing.
Yeah, we get to show them how to work the telescopes.
This is a 9-inch refracting telescope.
We get to show them what we've been doing with the light pollution.
And also, we could also show them Cygnus and the Summer Triangle and other constellations.
Avianna and I went stargazing one day.
Hercules.
Oh, look, Orion.
It's easy to find.
Yeah, because, like, Betelgeuse is, like, very bright. Oh, look, it's the Big Dipper.
The Big Dipper is a bear?
Oh, look, it's Bootes. It's your favorite one.
I know, I love it.
So here's Cassiopeia.
Your favorite, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it looks like a lightning bolt, don't you think? The myth is that Cassiopeia said that she was so beautiful and that she was even more beautiful than the sea nymphs. So then the sea nymphs complained to the god Poseidon, and to punish Cassiopeia, Poseidon put her in the sky.
Can't wait to look at some stars.
Set up the blanket.
Yep.
So I can lay down. Oh.
Do you see anything? What do you see?
I see that bright star. We should try looking for the Big Dipper, though.
Yeah, that's, like, so easy to find. Wait, can you find it? At other places, I can just, like, spot it out like that. Can you find Boots?
I can't really see it.
I can barely see it. I think I can see that really bright star.
Yeah.
Arcturus, yeah.
We really were looking forward to seeing all the stars. We decided to call Tina for help.
So this is where Tina works.
Yeah.
Let's go in.
Tina is our mentor in Science Club for Girls.
Okay, so this is the last flight of stairs until we reach the roof.
Oh, there's Tina.
Hi, Tina. Hey, Tina.
Hi, ladies.
Tina is studying at Harvard, and she's getting her PhD in astrophysics.
Yeah, we were out stargazing, and we couldn't see, like, any stars.
We're not that far away from the city right now. We're at the Harvard Astronomy Department, so the idea of problems with light is exactly what you guys just said. It's a big issue, right? I'm an astronomer. Yeah. I want to look up at the stars, and you guys couldn't see that many stars at all, right?
Yeah.
Having too many lights around prevents you from being able to see the stars up there. But, you know, light pollution is actually a really big environmental problem, not just for astronomers. There's a lot of inefficient lighting. So the different types of bulbs that we use, and then sometimes we lose a lot of light if it's pointing upwards rather than downwards, things like that. So that's just waste of energy. That's why we call it pollution, because it's actually affecting our environment, even though it may not be, you know, something tangible like, you know, chemicals in the water or something like that. When you're looking at the Earth from space, you'll see large pockets of light glowing from the cities. You can map out entire city areas and streets from space based on that. There are very few areas that are completely dark.
Whoa, look at that. The East Coast and the West Coast. They're so bright.
One of the big projects this year for the International Year of Astronomy is called the Great Worldwide Star Count.
The Great Worldwide Star Count? Oh, cool.
I'm really excited you guys came to me with this problem that you guys had.
So you basically count stars?
Yeah, the Great Worldwide Star Count, what it's trying to do is trying to measure light pollution by counting stars. So when you're at the park, you can only see the brightest stars. So the more faint stars you can see is actually a measure of light pollution.
We're not scientists, so how can we, like, do this?
So we can figure out a method to quantify light pollution and do this Great Worldwide Star Count, and therefore we're scientists. You don't have to have a degree or anything to be a scientist. As far as I'm concerned, you're experiments and you're investigating things. That's the definition of a scientist. So the constellation that I've chosen to do for the Great Worldwide Star Count is the constellation of Cygnus, which is inside the Summer Triangle. So the Summer Triangle is made up of these three stars here. So there's Vega, there's Altair, and there's Deneb. And one of those stars is actually the tip of the constellation Cygnus. So when we talk about stars and how bright they are, we refer to a magnitude system. When we're going to be talking about light pollution, we're talking about a limiting magnitude. And everyone who's participating in the Great Worldwide Star Count will be using the same system. So if there's a lot of background light, some of these fainter stars in this constellation are not going to be visible. But say we can't see any stars except the brightest star, right? And one of the brightest stars in the sky is Vega. So that will be an example where light pollution is really bad. So this would be a limiting magnitude of 1. And then going onwards, other features become visible.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, got it.
Eventually, so there's this interesting S-shaped pattern that happens in the middle of the cross. That too, if you can actually see that, then we're in good shape. And then, you know, you get to a point when you really can't, just too many stars to figure out anything.
Let's see a SciGirls profile.
Hi, my name is Miranda. I'm 12 years old. I enjoy playing the piano, reading. Love this book. Drawing.
Here's my mom, and she's drawing.
Hi, how are you? Hola, mi.
And a lot more. Ferocious kitty. The lair of Oreo. There he is. So here's my room. So there's the Wall of Fame, my desk, my family.
I had a great time. Hasta pronto. Bye.
Hasta pronto.
Avi and I had just stopped at my house.
So what do you need?
Telescopes.
To pick up some supplies that we need to do the star count. The star charts, flashlights, red lights, maps.
If you zip it out, I got the jackets.
Why don't we locate ourselves? How far away should we go to take our data?
Well, near the country where it's like
less light, so where we can really see stars and do the star count.
Why don't we start 50 miles away? And then we can have like 10 mile intervals so that we can see the difference as we get closer into the city.
Well, we'll start in Westminster. And we'll end in like Harvard Square.
Tina! Sorry, ladies.
We called Tina so that we could go somewhere darker to see the stars.
Great to see you.
You too.
Are you excited?
Yeah.
All right, let's go.
Thank you, Tina, for helping us find.
Yeah, we're so excited.
We're on the road at last. We're ready to go to our first site.
Woohoo! We're headed out to the country.
I love Tina. She's my favorite mentor teacher.
Have you seen like all the stars before, or is this going to be something new for you?
Well, we both went camping.
Yeah,
and
Gloucester,
yeah. Like full of stars.
So then did you know any of the constellations at that time? Could you pick anything out?
Big Dipper.
Yeah,
Big
Dipper.
Little Dipper.
As we go out to the darker sites, there's going to be less buildings around, and so there should be less background light. And the thing with astronomy, when you're looking for stars, it's all about contrast. So, you know, you're comparing a bright point in the sky, and it stands out more if the background around it is just darker, right? So what happens is if there's all these buildings around, then it sends up all this light, and that's, you know, the background light. And so the difference between the bright point and the background light, if there's a lot of buildings around, is less. So it's harder to see the faint things because of that. So you want to, you know, decrease the background light as much as possible so that these things stand out more.
Aha! I got it! Contrast! Now I know how to fix Jake's skateboard. But this light bulb over my head might just cause a problem.
Do you guys think we're there?
Are we there?
Because it's really
dark.
We're
pretty close. All right, guys, we're here.
Wow.
There's so many stars.
Like,
it's like unbelievable.
I know.
It's like I'm in like a movie, just watching it.
It's a lot different than the playground.
A lot. It's like 20, 30 times better. It's like we can see the brighter ones, and then if you look closely, you can see the smaller ones.
More. I found Cassiopeia. It's pretty exciting.
Really?
Yeah.
It's pretty fascinating. It's really overwhelming when you realize just how many stars there are out there. Most of the stars that we see in the night sky are actually all part of the Milky Way. So they're part of our own galaxy. So we're in the Milky Way, so we're seeing stars that are, you know, nearer us or farther away, but the actual number of stars in the Milky Way itself is something on the order of like 10 billion. So, you know, even a bit more than that. So we're talking about a lot of stars. It's far, far more than you can count. So can you find it, the Summer Triangle?
Yeah. Well, maybe we might need help from our constellation chart.
Good idea.
So star charts are like the map of the sky. They just help you know which star is part of which constellation so that you don't get like lost.
But right? Remember, it's dark outside, so
we need our headlights.
We use red lights when we're stargazing because our eyes aren't as sensitive to the red lights as it is to the white lights.
So when you have a map of the ground, you hold it on the ground, and then you look in your directions. A map of the sky, what do you do? You can't look at it this way.
You have to point it upward.
You have to point it upward.
Oh, that makes sense.
We're going up. Okay.
Yep. I'm looking up. Whoa. I'm okay.
So now you got 1, 2, 3. Is that much?
Yep. We look for the Summer Triangle because it's very easy to like find.
And there's one bright star right there.
Yeah.
So we can find like the brightest star to the left.
Yeah, west. I think I found it.
Yeah, I found it.
So that's Vega.
Look, there's Altair. And there's Deneb.
Yeah, I can see that.
Wow. Once we find the Summer Triangle, we see Deneb, and then we know that Deneb is part of Cygnus, so we can already start the star count.
Limiting magnitude 1. No stars in the cross are visible.
I say I can see more than that.
Yeah, me too.
Limiting magnitude 6. S-shaped curve of stars visible.
And then you can see this S. See the long tail.
Yeah, you can see the fainter stars.
You can see a star.
So we've got this S shape, so past limiting magnitude 6.
So then we must be on 7.
Yep.
Too many stars to count.
Too many.
Does that look like the situation we've got here?
Yeah.
All right, so I think we've really got to a dark location, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It says for latitude, it's 42.54.
After we saw what the limiting magnitude was, we took out the smartphone that had GPS coordinates of the site. So then we wrote them down on the notebook.
We're right there. So next time, why don't we do it near North Leominster?
I was freezing at the last place. I was like an icicle.
All right, we're here, ladies. Run out.
So there's Deneb.
And then
there's
Vega.
It's a lot more clear than the S for the magnitude 5 or 6.
Yeah, the V is a lot clearer than the S because like we can only see like one or two stars near the third star down.
Yeah.
So I think
It's like limiting magnitude 5, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. 5. Check.
Ready to go to site number 3?
Yeah.
Perfect. Let's go.
I wonder what we're going to get for our next site.
Okay, so we're about 30 miles away from the city. We need help finding the summer triangle.
Yeah, we're having a bit of
difficulties. Me and Miranda had trouble seeing Cygnus at one of the locations, which was 30 miles away from the city.
The summer triangle was where? Above us.
It was right above us.
It was right, exactly. It was right above us, right? But it's no longer there. So what's happening as the night progresses?
The sky moves, or we move.
The earth slowly turns. Right?
That's right, the earth is rotating.
Oh wait, I knew that, but I didn't know how it applied to stars. Now I know.
For like from our vantage point, like we don't necessarily feel the earth moving, but what do we see moving?
The sky.
Right, the sky changes as the night goes on. The constellations that were overhead earlier on the night are not gonna be overhead anymore. They're gonna be closer to the horizon.
Yeah.
So the fact that we're not seeing them probably just means we're not looking in the right spot, right? So that's where we've gotta move.
Okay. I can only see the first top two.
Yeah.
If we can only see two,
The
whole V doesn't really count.
Yeah, it doesn't exist to us.
Yeah, so I guess we'll have to go with limiting magnitude 4.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what do you wanna look at?
That star.
Yeah.
We're very interested.
Wait, it looks
a small white dot surrounded by
other little
dots.
Yeah,
it's like this, and then a little one. I just thought that it was Jupiter for a second, just because it has like moons.
Galileo, when he looked through his telescope, one of the first things that he observed was Jupiter.
Yeah,
and he saw that Jupiter was a circular sphere with a few other small things around it.
So it's right.
So it's Jupiter.
Oh, right. It's Jupiter.
Yay!
Sort of feels like New Year's Eve or Christmas because you always stay up late. So it's kind of weird staying at past my bedtime.
I think that astronomers keep up their energy by drinking a lot of coffee.
So I'm really tired. I'm very tired. And here's Avianna.
Hi, my name is Avianna and this is my life.
I love to swim and play soccer. I'm on a swim team. It's called the Sea Dogs.
These are my trophies.
And I'm on a soccer team called Bays. Very fun.
My friend got me this for my birthday. And Miranda got me this for my birthday too.
It's my karate medal. I won first place.
And here we go. On the move again.
When we got to site number 4, we got to see a lot of stars, but not as much as our darkest site. When we looked at our data, at that point, it kind of evened out when we thought that it would be like going even lower as we got closer to the city.
What did you guys find out?
We think that it's
limiting magnitude 5.
Now that we finished site number 4, we're going to our last site in the city. So now that we're back in the city, I realize that there's a lot of lights on because a lot of people are asleep at night, businesses are already closed, and still there's so many lights on that it's like a waste of like light and energy.
This is a very wasteful light. It's like blinding yourself just by looking at it.
Well, at the good lighting that we saw was at the fire station. It's shielded and it's used downwards like it's supposed to be used.
Let's go.
Heading back into the city was like very surprising.
So already, how does the sky compare to our last location?
It's not as many stars, but now I see the summer triangle. It would be limiting magnitude 4, which is kind of weird because that's what we got before.
Yes.
Here, we got limiting magnitude 4. After being in all these dark sites, all of a sudden you see all these lights. It's very bright and surprising. You could actually see the sky glow.
So look, all that sky glow.
Sky glow is a type of light pollution that you can see this little bubble across the city that is lighter than the whole other sky.
Well, look, where there's all those lights, like, you can't see any stars.
Yeah, but if you go up, we can.
Yeah, so I guess that shows how much light pollution affects us.
Miranda and I, we were so bummed out that when we looked around, there was so much bad lighting. So we thought we could make a difference. So we went back to Miranda's house and made our own light shield.
Now I need to take off this part. Now I can take this off. Let's turn it on. Okay, you obviously see that this is horrible.
I don't.
We need to plan it. How do you want the design to be?
It has to be down. So like.
So you mean circles. Something like, you know, like those cones the dogs wear? It should be something like, it's kind of like a cone. We need to find
the circumference.
7?
It says 7.
So it's like kind of projecting it like that. Yeah, we're trying to make it sort of to shine on where you actually want it so that it doesn't have like excessive light going everywhere. So if we tape it like this, right?
Yeah, and then we can like cut around
it.
We used Miranda's constellation on her ceiling, so we turned off all the lights.
So why don't we try our first one? No, you can't see any stars. So if you had one like this, I mean, it would block some of the light, but
it won't block
all. You still can't see any stars, right?
Oh, too bad.
What else could we use to like make it not shine through? Like, we can't use plastic because like that doesn't work with it.
Plastic will melt.
Wait, tinfoil. The tinfoil basically is just gonna lock in all the light so that it won't leak.
Let's go test it, Miranda. Leaker, non-leaker.
Yeah, I think this one is gonna be a lot better.
Okay.
So that's the
mall. It's the mall. Let's just call it the mall.
Oh, cool.
Hallelujah. It's directed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Wow. Yeah, so like if everybody shielded their lights,
we'd still be able to see some stars.
Well, yeah, but it's still good because you can actually
love
see them.
Light.
Avi and I are at our house. We're just looking over our data and trying to figure out what it means.
71.70 degrees west.
So at our first location, we got limiting magnitude of 7.
And for the second location, it was limiting magnitude 5.
One thing that Avi and I did notice is that if you have lights around you, you can't see stars. So the less lights that you have around you, the more stars you can see. And the more lights that you have around you, the less stars you can see.
Got it. So now I'm ready to help Jake.
Constellation, do we see?
Cygnus, right?
Yeah.
Uploading our data was very rewarding.
Latitude was.
Everybody can do this, and I just got to help like scientists all over the world. So yeah, it was very cool.
Star party!
Welcome to our star party.
Yeah, welcome.
This is the pizza people. When I finished my road trip, I felt like a real astronomer, and I just felt so amazed and excited.
Before I entered the star count, I didn't realize how much light pollution was affecting the whole world, and now I know that I have to do something to change that. Look, there's Jupiter.
Oh my gosh.
Hey, lady.
Hi, Dina.
So you guys ready to look at more telescopes?
Yeah.
Ooh, red lights.
I think it's really cool.
See Jupiter.
It was a great experience to do all of this, have our friends here and share what we did.
We finished!
Okay, so all you gotta do is skate and dance and leave the rest to me. Oh man, your board is gonna shine.
You sure about that?
Oh, I am totally sure. Just trust me.
I do.
Good, then trust me about this too. This move?
The bobblehead. I made that up.
Yeah, don't use it. Go, 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 go! You're on! No, trust me!
Oh, man. Iz, thank you so much. You're a real star.
So are you, Jake. Hey, I think they want an encore.
Whoa. What should I do?
The bobblehead!
This is a type of telescope called a Dobsonian scope. Mm-hmm. It's a bit different from what you've been using before. Those used a lens to focus the light. So I'm going to put the barrel down. It's not a lens, right? What is it at the bottom?
A mirror.
Mirror. And the mirror is not a normal flat mirror. It's actually concave, slightly curved. Mm-hmm. And this is a viewfinder, so it'll let you look at the objects on the sky. And you're going to aim it, the telescope, looking through here first.
Where you want it.
Exactly, where you want to go. And then you'll look through the eyepiece.
All four of us love to cook.
The menu is collard greens and peach cobbler.
You guys, this is awful for you.
Our goal, to make them more nutritious.
That good.
So the four of us have been in the May Day Parade every year.
This year we wanted to do a huge group puppet together.
And we could sort of engineer it to move.
I think I want a calm horse. We're trying to figure out which horse would be best scientifically to be the smoothest ride.
Oh, I love the one on the ground.
The PBS Kids Games app has games. Lots and lots of games. All packed into one place you can take with you wherever you go. It's all on the PBS Kids Games app, and it's free for download today.
Major funding for SciGirls is provided by the National Science Foundation, supporting education and research across all fields of science and engineering. The National Science Foundation, where discoveries begin.
Additional funding is provided by ExxonMobil.
The SciGirls website is off the hook. You can set up a profile, find new friends, create a page for your science project, watch SciGirls videos, and have fun. So come on, be a SciGirl on PBSKidsGo.org. See you there. Bye.
SCIPIRLS.
Anything's possible if you imagine it.
PBS Kids has gone pink.
La, 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 la.
With Pinkalicious and Peterific.
This is so cool!
Pinkatacular, right?
Discover how your pink imagination...
We're inventors!
...can bring creativity to life.
She moves in everything.
Ladies and gentlemen, presenting...
Pinkalicious and Peterific. Weekdays on PBS Kids. And watch it anytime on the PBS Kids video app.